This is Chapter 9, Molecular Geometry and Some Bonding Theories. So I'm going to run through this pretty quick, but you have the nice advantage of pausing it and taking a look at anything we talk about in this chapter. So starting off, taking a look here, there's a lot of different shapes that we're going to be looking at and how to name them. So there's a couple things we have to pay attention to. One is we're always talking about some central atom, and it can be a variety of different chains and number of atoms in there, but you have to pick something to start with. And you need some other atom on either side of it, both sides. So you have to have at least three atoms to talk about this, because any two atoms would just be linear and there's no other options. And then we have other electron pairs that may be on that central atom, which affects the shape. So we'll see how these things play out as we're going along. So taking a look here, we can see some of the common shapes you guys probably remember from last year. Linear, trigonal, planar, tetrahedral, and so on. You can take a look at those and try to remember these from last year. So this is just some general diagram here. A is not a real element, neither is B. It's not boron. It's just the idea that, you know, this is how these things can come together. One thing that this slide is pointing out here is electron domains is only a location where electrons are found between two atoms or attached to whatever atom we happen to be talking about. So this atom here happens to have four electron domains. Three of them are bonding and one is non-bonding. So bonding, 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 and non-bonding. So it has four on there. And its shape is based upon the three of those bondings and the one non-bonding. But just remember that double bond there is still just one electron domain. Good enough. Okay, so looking at this one here, we'll kind of go back and forth a little. Notice again that this one here has four electron domains. I'm not really concerned about what's attached to them. So based on the fact that it has four electron domains means that it is tetrahedral. And if all those things are exactly the same, that value of bond angle is 109.5 degrees. You do need to memorize that. For one reason or another, that's just a number that College Board likes you to know. Okay, and again, they all have to be the same thing. So same atoms on there, so we have equal repulsion all the way around. So here's some of the shapes, again, based upon a central atom, which they don't show here, but the central atom you can assume or know is right there in the center. And having two electron domains makes it linear, three, trigonal planar, and so on. And again, this is without even considering what these things are, or we're just going to make a general assumption that they're all the same. Okay? The other thing just to point out, and we'll come back to this I think a little bit later, is this whole idea of S and P. Remember going back to something you learned last year about the octet, and each orbital can occupy two electrons, or two electrons can occupy it. So we have an S, and then we have three P's in which we can find electrons, right? So based upon if I have only two locations where electrons are found, we are actually having this hybrid set because these are different. They have different energy levels. So what we have coming together here is one of the S's, or the only S, and one of the P's coming together and blending and making something common. So that was what we call an SP hybrid set of orbitals. But then you also have the other two P's that are just kind of hanging out, maybe holding an extra pair of electrons each. And they're doing their own thing, but they're not hybridized. And we can have the same conversation down with the other ones. So a really easy way to look at this, and don't go too far with it, is simply to say, okay, I have two orbitals, SP, two letters. If I have three, SP2, three letters. And if there happens to be four, one, two, three, four, then it's SP4. So again, one S and three P's. Put it all together. Easy enough. All right, so if you ever have to do this on a test, and you probably will, the easiest way to determine the geometry is, one, take that formula, do the whole valence electron thing. So, okay, nitrogen's got five electrons, hydrogen's got one each, So, okay, hydrogen. I got three of them, so I'm just going to say three electrons total. And then draw it out like we've done in class, and then surround the extra pair around nitrogen. Given that, just draw it out based on that central atom. And if you do that, you'll end up with a shape, which is tetrahedral, but then you have this valence pair of electrons here, which is going to be different as far as what we call the molecular geometry, which we'll come back to in a few minutes. Hey, there we are. So, two different conversations you're having there. One is based on the electron domain, which is really easy. Just find things attached to the central atom. And again, a double bond is one electron domain. So in this case, after drawing it out, I see that we have four locations where electrons are found around the central atom nitrogen. So it is tetrahedral. But I have one lone pair of electrons up here, which I don't actually see when I'm looking at the model, which takes me over here. So when I look at this one, this is what I see. And based upon that shape of a central atom with three other bonding atoms further down, gives me a shape called trigonal pyramidal. So it kind of looks like a pyramid with three sides. Easy enough. So two things, electron domain, which is strictly location based upon those, and you see that in the middle, and then molecular geometry based upon what you see. And these are some options. This is a really good slide because it kind of breaks it down. So everything starts off as tetrahedral, regardless of what is there, if it's an atom or just an electron pair. So remember, there's a pair of electrons sitting up here, which we don't see, and there's two pair of electrons over here, which we don't see, but their shapes are based upon that. Okay? So this is right out of your book, and these are some good examples. Again, looking at this one here, to start on the other side actually, being carbon dioxide, it has two locations where electrons can be found. There's no other lone pairs on carbon, so that is simply linear. And its sp hybridization would simply be sp, because there's two locations in which electrons can be found. Done. Okay, you can take a look at that. Going over to bond angles, again, if this was all equal, I had three chlorines as an example attached to carbon with no other electron pairs, all the bond angles would be the same. They'd just be simply 120 because they're all equal, 360 divided by 3. In this case, because I have a double bond, there's more electron density between the carbon and the oxygen here. So therefore, that extra amount of electrons in that location has more repulsion to the other electron pairs, and it pushes them closer together or further away from the carbon-oxygen double bond. Okay? Again, right out of your book, looking at this one, the same idea is, as long as I have three electron domains, the shape is trigonal planar in regard to electrons. But when you start throwing in non-bonding pairs, now I'm no longer trigonal planar, but I am bent because it's having a part of the shape that is no longer filled with a bonding atom. So it gives me the shape bent. Sliding over here, and just a further explanation as far as how you get those shapes. When you have two nuclei, so one atom on either side, let's call this one here the central atom, and this one here the exterior bonding atom over there. Putting my arrow in the right place. These two positive nuclei are pulling on those electrons, and they're forcing that density, that electron density, into a smaller location. So it's kind of tight. But when I don't have a central atom over in this location, the electrons are more free to spread out, and it's going to be a little bit larger, and it's going to push the other electron pairs further down. Okay? Well, we're at about 10 minutes here, so I'm going to stop here, and we'll start the next lecture after this one.